It's time for our next session. So find your seat and we will start. As I said at the end of the last one, this session is Kaspars talking about the resurrection. As Adventists, we didn't really understand the resurrection. And so Kaspars will lead us to Scripture and what it really teaches. So come on up, Kaspars.
Thanks, Richard. Let me get my slides up here. Let's open up with prayer. Loving Father, you've sent your Son, you've revealed your Son, and we have your Son. Those of us who believe in you, we have your Son, and in him we find life. And so, Lord, help us to understand that life and how that life relates to the resurrection and how that life gives shape to resurrection and how that life gives meaning to resurrection, the hope of that resurrection. We ask these things in the name of your Son. Amen. So I've been given my first talk here. The topic is resurrection, and I'm very pleased and thankful to be able to be with you and to dive into God's Word and to consider some of these issues. I think these are extremely important theological foundational concepts, and for those of us who have been Adventist, it can sometimes take years to undo all of the worldview and all of the system that has been constructed in our minds, whether overtly or subconsciously. And then in time comes, you know, over the years, you'll be noticing things and you'll see things in the Word of God, and it'll open up your mind in a new way. And so my hope and my prayer is that we can do that a little bit more today. We can continue to walk toward the light and to study the resurrection. So what is resurrection? Theologians like to come up with fancy words and use them a lot. I teach at a seminary, and so I dabble with these words, things like superlapsarianism and infralapsarianism. Not even the theologians know what they mean, or maybe they disagree about them. But even ordinary terms that we use in Christian parlance can sometimes lose their meaning. If you say it enough times, it becomes ephemeral, and it just seems hard to understand. But what is resurrection? It's a kind of a part of our Christianese lingo, and yet we want to understand it in its biblical depths and what it really means. Now, is resurrection a kind of a recitation? You think of the paramedics bringing someone back to life. They zap a person, and then now they're finally back in order. I mean, it starts with a re, so maybe it's similar to that. I mean, is that what resurrection is? Or is it maybe some kind of revivification, when you are made alive again? That sounds kind of like resurrection. Is that all it is, being made alive? You know, you're dead and now you're alive physically. The organs are working. The heart is beating. Is that what resurrection is? Is it a kind of reanimation where you are inanimate, not moving, and now all of a sudden you're moving, you can talk, you can do things? Is that what resurrection is? Is it a kind of a recreation? Now, you know, of course, the punchline, it's not recreation. That's what the title of the talk is. But nevertheless, the question remains in our minds, what is resurrection? Sometimes I think even as Christians, maybe those of you who have never been Seventh-day Adventist, haven't thought and considered in a deeper light, what really is resurrection? And is it simply some kind of coming back to life, a physical body that is simply being made into something different? So I want to look at that this morning, and I want to consider at the beginning two key issues, I think, that plague Adventism and that skew their view of what resurrection is and really cheapen it. And one of those would be how they understand death, and the other would be how they understand life. So Basically, I would submit to you that in Seventh-day Adventism, physical resurrection is simply, basically, ultimately equated with eternal life. And so eternal life, physical resurrection, those are kind of the same thing. Okay, so they're interchangeable. And then the other side of that coin is that death is nothing more than physical death. Okay, so physical resurrection, that's the goal. That is eternal life. That's what we're looking forward to. And death is just nothing more than physical death. And so they will contend, for example, in their fundamental beliefs, that spiritualism originated with Satan's first lie to Eve. You will not surely die, Genesis 3, verse 4. His words were the first sermon on the immortality of the soul. Today, throughout the world, religions of all sorts unwittingly repeat this error. For many, the divine sentence that the soul who sins shall die has been reversed to say, the soul, even though it sins, shall live eternally. Now, how could we respond to that? I would say what's going on here is there's a category error taking place. Because if eternal life is simply continuing to live on physically without, you know, being ceasing to live, then of course this is going to be a contradiction. But eternal life, we know biblically, is much more than that. And I would say actually that it is the Adventist religion which is believing in the lie of Satan, because it is not truly believing when God said, on the day that you eat of this fruit, you will die. And so there is a proverbial gap in Adventism. There's a gap between death and when they claim death actually took place. In Genesis 2, God says, of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. And the Hebrew there is very strong. It's a particular construction that makes it extremely emphatic. And yet, according to Adventism, Adam only died 930 years later. So there is a gap between what God says and what Adventism actually says happens. Okay, and then likewise, there's also a gap in terms of eternal life, because as Seventh-day Adventists believe, quotes, while John points out that we receive the gift of eternal life when we accept Jesus Christ as personal Savior, 1 John 5, the actual realization of this gift will take place when Christ returns. Only then will we be changed from mortal to immortal, from corruptible to incorruptible. So here we have another gap. We have a gap between what Jesus is claiming, and yet Adventism rejects what Jesus claims and says that life begins only with the return of Christ. So we have two gaps here. We have a gap in death, and we have a gap in life, and we have a skewing of what those two terms mean, and we have a cheapening of what they mean. And so because of that, resurrection can't be understood in its full biblical sense. Okay. Now, the background of this, of course, is that Adventism is a physicalist religion. It is concerned with physical things and thereby downplays or diminishes spiritual realities. I want to give you guys a couple of quotes here from, again, Seventh-day Adventists believe. It says the following: it is frequently suggested that human moral and spiritual dimensions reveal something about God's moral and spiritual nature. But since the Bible teaches that man comprises an indivisible unity of body, mind, and soul, man's physical features must also in some way reflect God's image. But isn't God a spirit? They're asking rhetorically. How could a spirit be associated with any form or shape? A brief study of the angels reveals that they, like God, are spiritual beings, Hebrews 1, yet they always appear in human form. Could it be that a spiritual being may have a spiritual body with a form and features? And if we go on, we see, it's not turning. Sorry. This is not going back. Okay. Why is it? Okay. The Bible indicates that some people have seen parts of God's person. Okay, this is where it gets really interesting. Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and the 70 elders saw his feet. Although he refused to show his face, after covering Moses with his hands, God revealed his back to him as he passed by. God appeared to Daniel in a judgment scene vision as the Ancient of Days seated on a throne. So Adventism concludes that there must be something physical about God. Christ is described as the image of the invisible God. You should have stuck with that quotation, I would say. and the express image of his person. These passages seem to indicate that God is a personal being and has a personal form. This should come as no surprise, for man was created in the image of God. Now, as I read those, as I was looking through Seventh-day Adventist belief, and I saw the phrase personal being in a personal form. So if you want to have a personal being, there must be some kind of a personal form associated with it. And mine immediately thought to one individual, one pioneer of Seventh-day Adventism, that is one James White. Because, of course, he has an issue with the Trinity, because if he conceives of God as physical, then he has to have three separate personalities, i.e. three separate physical beings. And so he says the Trinity does away with the personality of God and his Son, Jesus Christ. And he goes on to say, what is God? He is material, organized intelligence, possessing both body and parts. Man is in his image. That's incredible to me. What is Jesus Christ? He is the Son of God, and he is like his Father, being the brightness of the Father's glory and the express image of his person. He is material intelligence with body parts and passions, possessing immortal flesh and immortal bones. In the beginning, man was created in the likeness of God, not only in character, but in form and feature. So you see here that Adventism is a deeply physical religion. It is even ascribing physical features to the eternal, invisible God. Now let's look at what the Westminster Confession of Faith describes who God is. It says the following: there is but one living, only living and true God, who is infinite in being and perfection, and most pure spirit, invisible, without body, parts, or passions, immutable, immense, eternal, incomprehensible, almighty, most wise, most holy, most free, most absolute, working all things according to the counsel of his own immutable and righteous will for his own glory. That is who God is. Now, you may have caught this, but as I was going through this, my mind was just blown, because it seems that, it looks like James White has taken what the Westminster Confession of Faith says and has turned it upside down completely. Look at this again. Without body, parts, or passions. What does James White say? He is person with body, parts, and passions, quoting exactly from the Westminster Confession of Faith, but turning it upside down, possessing immortal flesh and immortal bones. This is satanic wickedness, in my view. This is really evil to do something like this. But that is what is the background of Adventism. We need to understand that as we talk about resurrection, because this is going to be an important thing for us. Now, I want to give you guys an earlier quote from in church history. So we're talking about Christianity now and dealing about the nature, understanding a bit about the nature of death, what death really is, because we need to understand death before we can understand eternal life. This is St. Augustine. He says the following: what does this mean? He who believes in me, though he were dead, just as Lazarus is dead, yet shall he live, for he is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Such was the answer he gave the Jews concerning their fathers long ago dead, that is, concerning Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. He's not the God of the dead, but of the living. For all live unto him. Believe then, and though you were dead, listen to that, yet shall you live. But if you do not believe, even while you are alive, you are dead. Let us prove this also by the fact that if you do not believe, though you live, you are dead. To the one who was delaying to follow him, that's Jesus, and saying, let me go first and bury my father, the Lord said, let the dead bury their dead, but come and follow me. There was a dead man needing to be buried. There was there also dead people to bury the dead. The one was dead in the flesh, the others dead in soul. And how does death come to the soul? When faith is wanting. How does death come to the body? When the soul is wanting. for faith is the life of the soul. So you see here that physical death is an entailment and a consequence of spiritual death. And unless we understand spiritual death, we are robbing physical death of its meaning and its understanding. Why would it happen? Why do human beings die? It's unnatural. It's not natural. It's not part of God's created order. It's something that is very strange. And by extension, unless we understand eternal life, we will not be able to understand resurrection and what that means and how resurrection is an entailment of eternal life, the life that we can have right now. So I want to say to you that eternal life is more than resurrection. Resurrection is a part of eternal life, but it does not exhaust the meaning of eternal life. So that's what Jesus said to his disciples. He is the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. They hadn't risen from the dead yet, but yet he's the God of the living. So there is a resurrection that is to come, but this living God still is not ashamed to call himself the God of what? The decomposing Abraham? Decomposing Isaac? Decomposing Jacob? He's the God of the living. You are quite wrong. Look at this verse in John 6. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Well, Jesus, you didn't have to say that. Eternal life is being resurrected, so that's what we understand. No, there's a distinction between eternal life, which comes now to the believer, and the inevitable entailment of that, which is the resurrection, which is to come. Here's another verse. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. Now we know this verse very well. It's familiar to us, but notice that Jesus is saying here, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. Not the same thing. They're not the same thing. So then what is eternal life? Well, a couple ways we could look at it. There are other passages. Let's take a glance at some of these. Jesus says in John 4, whoever drinks of the water that I give to him will never be thirsty again. The water that I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Let me say that as an Adventist, I had no idea what that meant. I had no idea what that meant. To drink from this living water we sang about this morning earlier. Eternal life is to have an eternal spring of welling water up and within you that you have right now. You do not have to wait for the physical resurrection for that to be a reality in your life. If you trusted in Jesus today, you have that. You have this spring of water, this inexhaustible supply that the woman at the well was looking for. You have that today. Jesus says in John 17, his upper room discourse, this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. Forget about eternally existing in a body. Eternal life is knowing God. It's knowledge about God. And the person who is carnal, the person who has their mindset on the flesh, that's something so boring, so uninteresting. But eternal life is knowing God. What do you think we're going to be doing in the eternal state in heaven? No. We're going to be knowing and learning about this God. We're going to be studying more about him and living with this God that we can even begin to know today in our salvation. What is eternal life? Paul says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Eternal life is Jesus Christ. That's quite simple. Eternal life is Jesus Christ. You either have him or you don't. And if you have him, you have eternal life. Now, I want to take this a little bit of a different direction now and bring a different understanding here. Something that will help us to understand the continuity. I want to stress especially the continuity between the eternal life that we have now and the day of resurrection when we will be given these new bodies, which does happen and will happen, and we trust in God's word that it will happen. And so in order to understand that, I want to look at the life of Jesus and in his incarnation, how we can understand the life of Jesus as mirroring ours. Because although the image of God is something that we've seen a lot as a it's a familiar piece of terminology, and I want to talk about it more in some of the other talks that later on today and tomorrow. What is exactly the image of God? One way of thinking about it is to say that the image of God is like the image of Christ. And so in that sense, you could say that we are not just made in the image of God. More particularly, we are made in the image of Christ. So everything that is true of him as a human is true of us. And I would say, actually, that the image is not prior, logically and theologically, the image of man, but it's the image of Christ that we are then based on. So let's look to the life of Jesus for help to understand what happened to him as a man so that we can understand what is our future in redemptive history. Okay, so let's review some of our Trinitarianism. I did a Trinitarian quiz last time, so maybe we could do it now. How many persons of the Trinity are there? One? Someone said one? Three, yeah. There is one divine essence, right? So there's divinity in Jesus. There is one undivided essence, invisible. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, undivided, one single essence. And then there is humanity, Jesus, as a full human being. And that is called, theologians use the technical term, the hypostatic union. Jesus Christ is the God-man. These two natures, the human nature and the divine nature, exist alongside. They're not separated as though there's some kind of schizophrenia going on, but they're also not blended together as though Jesus were some kind of Superman or someone out of a Marvel comic book. No, he's a full human being with a body and a soul, and he is fully divine at the same time. And this is true of him eternally. Now, let's look at his humanity, because that is the part that pertains to us. We are made in the image of Christ. We have a body. We have a soul. What happened to the Lord Jesus Christ in his incarnation? In order to do that, I want to look at a book that has been very helpful to me. And I'm stealing a bit of Martin's thunder. He'll have a breakout session I really recommend you guys check out as well. But if you could are interested in this topic, it has been a very helpful book for me. It's been wonderful to dive into this. It's the title is He Descended to the Dead, An Evangelical Theology of Holy Saturday by Matthew Emerson. I want to look at what took place on Holy Saturday. We know about Good Friday, we know about the resurrection on Sunday, but what took place on Saturday as a means of understanding what is our future in Christ? Now, in order to do that, we need to cite the Apostles' Creed, and this is, of course, well known to us. I'm going to say it. You can all say it together, actually. Let's maybe say it together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, as we recited that, you may have had a bit of some qualms, some issues with two particular phrases in there, and I want to highlight those at this point. He descended into hell. Whoa, what's going on there? And, of course, the Holy Catholic Church. Now, let's dispose of the second one. Really quickly, Catholic just means universal. There is one universal church. There is not one sect which is more right than others. There is one universal church. Now, we obviously don't always agree in everything, but nevertheless, there is one body, there is one faith, one baptism, there is one universal church. So that is simply what the word Catholic means. Okay, it's not Roman Catholic, it's Catholic. But the second phrase is what I want to dwell on in particular. What does it mean that this ancient creed says he descended to hell? Initially, I want to say, first of all, that there's a lot of old language here, archaic language, like Catholic, and so it needs some explanation. The word hell earlier in English did not mean what it means today. In fact, the word hell is related to the word hole. You can see how they sound a little bit similar. Hell, hole. And they can, you can even have a word meaning hellhole, but that's a different thing. But so hell, in terms of its origins, in terms of its etymology, in the earlier time in English, had to do with the region under the earth, some kind of region below the earth. And I want to expand on that a little bit. This is something that we are not taught in Adventism. We don't understand it. It's going to be completely new to some of us, maybe. So before I talk about that, I want to just say that this particular creedal statement, that phrase, he descended to hell, some scholars, including Matthew Emerson, who wrote that book on Holy Saturday, would say that this was given so that in order to reject the ancient heresy of Apollinarianism. This is Apollinarianism basically was a heresy which stated that the soul, the human soul of Jesus, was the same thing as the divine essence. So you see there, one divided essence, undivided essence, is spanning across to the humanity of Jesus and is substituting for his soul. Okay? So therefore, you do have some kind of a super God here, demigod, and that is clearly not what is what Scripture teaches. And so if we see a distinction between Jesus' body and his soul, that's also going to apply in terms of Holy Saturday, which is why some would argue that this phrase, he descended into hell, he descended into the grave, was added to combat this particular understanding. Remember, Jesus has two natures, his humanity and his divinity, and his humanity contains everything that we have. There's nothing in his humanity that is different from our humanity, okay? So, there are a couple places in ancient Jewish understanding of the region below the earth. To describe those. There is Gehenna, and this, by the way, was basically the standard understanding in the intertestamental period. Between the close of the Old Testament and Jesus' incarnation, this was the standard understanding of the afterlife, okay? Gehenna was the first category. This is the place of the unrighteous, okay? So that's what Jesus is saying in Matthew 5. He uses a word there that I've inserted into the ESV, the Gehenna. He says, if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into Gehenna, the place of the unrighteous. The second compartment was called Tartarus. This is the place of the fallen angels, the demons, and the evil spirits. So this was a separate compartment. And Peter alludes to this in 2 Peter when he says, God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into Tartarus. That's the word, the Greek word that's being used there. And committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until the judgment. So it's a holding place, like a holding cell, for those fallen angels until the final judgment when Christ will come to judge the living and the dead. And then the final compartment is Abraham's bosom, sometimes also called paradise. Abraham's bosom, which is the place of the righteous. So in the parable that Jesus taught that Adventism scoffs at as being simply an allegory, Jesus says, the poor man died and was carried, this is Lazarus, was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. That's just so foreign to us. What in the world? Abraham's bosom, what does this mean? What does the word bosom even mean, incidentally? I want to talk a little bit about bosom, but one thing I want to note just as a side remark, you notice that Abraham's bosom is sometimes also called paradise. Now, what did Jesus say to the thief on the cross? You'll be with me in paradise. He didn't say you'll be with me in heaven. He said you'll be with me in paradise. Okay? So this is a paradise. I think about paradise. It's the word that the old Greek translators used to refer to Eden, a kind of Eden. But it's also seen as Abraham's bosom. Now, what is a bosom and why is Abraham mentioned here? When we think of a dinner feast in antiquity, we think of the Last Supper, for example. We often have this picture in mind. We have this nice modern Western table, and Jesus and disciples are sitting there, and you know, it's very familiar. It's etched in our minds. But that's not what the people in antiquity, in the ancient Near East, how they actually had meals. What they did instead is they didn't have this table with legs underneath it. They actually had the food set out basically around the ground, and then people lying down around that table, and on their left hand they were supporting themselves, and with their right hand they were eating. And additionally, they basically had to access the food kind of in a sideways way, so they were kind of piled along like sardines, okay? And so then, therefore, the person who is in front of you is by your chest, he's by your bosom, okay? Now, the place of honor was the person at the head of the table. So Abraham's bosom, there's a feast going on here, you're with Abraham, the paragon of faith, you had faith, and so you are given an honored place right next to Abraham. It's a special place of honor. That's what Abraham's bosom was taken to mean, okay? So how does this connect with Holy Saturday? Well, consider this. I want to give you guys a quotation from Psalm 16, but before I do that, I need to give you a little bit of an explanation about how Hebrew poetry works. So Hebrew poetry, unlike our poetry in English, where there's basically rhyme is the dominating form, and so rhyme is used to give poetry a beauty. There's both truth and beauty within poetry. That's what kind of sets apart poetry from ordinary prose. Instead, Hebrew used parallelism. They would take an A line and a B line, they would set them next to each other, and they would make them slightly different, but then they would increase the power of the message as a whole. It would make it more beautiful. My predecessor at Southern, Dr. Gentry, described this as the left and right speakers of a stereo system. Now, you guys know about stereo. Is the music that's coming on the left speaker and the right speaker, are they identical? Well, yes and no, right? There's a slight difference. There might be a delay. There might be a little bit of an effect added to one side. And then when you hear them together, it gives you 3D. It gives you a full orb picture. So you get more than simply the sum of the parts. That's what Hebrew parallelism is designed to do. So here's an example from Numbers 24, a prophecy of Jesus, the Messiah, coming. Balaam's speaking here, and he's speaking prophetically about Christ. He says, "I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near." Do you see that the verbs highlighted in green, they represent Hebrew verbs. They're close in meaning, but they're not exactly the same. Same for the pair of words now and near, these adverbs. That's what Hebrew parallelism was doing. It makes it more beautiful and gives it a power that shapes it. Here's that second part of the verse. "A star shall come out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel." Again, the star is connected with scepter, come is connected with rise, and Jacob is another name for Israel. Okay? Now, that's going to help us as we try to understand what Peter was saying on Pentecost when he was citing from Psalm 16. He was citing about the prophecy of Jesus that David was uttering. Now, what did David say? Here's the last verse there. Let's go on to this one. You know this all. "For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption." Here's the parallelism. Soul is not the same thing as Holy One, and Sheol is not the same thing as corruption. Now, they're connected, they're related, but they're not the same thing, and together they make it much more powerful and more expansive. So the soul of Jesus went to Sheol, the place of the grave, but the Holy One of Jesus did not see corruption because he was raised to newness of life. On the third day he rose again. Corruption refers to the physical body decaying, and yet the prophecy that David uttered promised that there would be no corruption of Jesus. He would be resurrected, and his soul in Sheol would transform that place forever. His soul in the realm of the dead would transform Sheol forever. Okay, I want to give you guys a couple of verses here, that passages that to me indicate, and Emerson has cited these in his book as well, that show that there is more to the grave than simply a body being placed in the grave. Okay, so here in Ephesians 4, Paul is talking about spiritual gifts. He's talking about Christ there, for it says, "When he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men." Now, the captives here are probably a reference to those evil imprisoned spirits that Christ decisively judged when he went to the place of the dead. So he didn't just go to see the righteous. He also went to proclaim to those evil spirits and defeat them once and for all time. So in saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions, the earth? There's more than just the surface of the earth. It's something that's below the earth in terms of the cosmic geography. He who descended is the one who has also ascended far above the heavens that he might fill all things. You see that? He's filling all things. Jesus is going everywhere in a sense. Here's another one, Romans 10. For Moses writes about the righteousness that is based on the law, that the person who does the commandments shall live by them, referencing Deuteronomy. But the righteousness that is based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend to heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. This is a little bit cryptic, but essentially what Paul seems to be saying here is, you don't have to go up to heaven to bring down a Messiah who can rescue you. He's the one who came down. And you don't have to go down into Sheol to bring him up from the dead. He did that himself. He did that for us. And so because of what he did, death has been defeated decisively for all time for those who believe in Jesus. And so that's why Paul goes on to say, what does it say? The word is near to you in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Amen. Another passage here, 1 Peter 3. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit. And here I'm adjusting the ESV a little bit. I think this is a better rendition. And it's speaking to Christ at that moment going and proclaiming to the spirits in prison, those evil spirits, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you. There is such richness to baptism. It is not just a simple symbol. There's much more going on there. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. Now again, Jesus went everywhere. He came down not just from heaven to be on earth. He descended into the lower regions so that he could conquer death ultimately and fully for us. Okay. So here's a quote I want to give you guys from J.A. McCullough. It's really impressive to me. No part of the universe, Hades, heaven, earth, was to be unvisited by him. This is implied in Philippians 2:10, when every knee on earth and in heaven and under the earth is going to bow to Christ. Christ's obedience even to death is the cause of his exaltation and his universal sovereignty, not only of the heavenly, over the heavenly and the earthly, but over those under the earth, the usual classical expression for those in Hades. He's sovereign over all. He's Lord over all. And so when Revelation says, you know, quoting Jesus saying here, I died and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of death and Hades. When you think of keys, you think of a prison. And for those who are believers, he's taken away that prison, that key forever. And one day, death and Hades themselves are going to be cast into the lake of fire. So Christ has transformed that prison, and it's no longer a prison in for those who believe in him. In fact, I would say that it's no longer, it's even more than Abraham's bosom for those who believe in him. It's now become the bosom of Christ. And so the beloved apostle who is at the side of Jesus, that's going to be all of us at death because we live in Christ. We have our being in him. Amen. So G.K. Beale says, the keys imagery is utilized to indicate that through the victory of the resurrection, Christ became king even over the realm of the dead in which he was formerly imprisoned. So let me go back here. Now, not only no longer Sorry, not only is he no longer held in death's bonds, but he also holds sway over who is released and retained in that realm. He has all authority. So when Jesus says all authority on heaven and on earth has been given to me, he really means it. Now here I want to give you guys a little bit of an illustration or a diagram. And the slide's not changing. Okay, here we go. So we think of heaven and earth, and we've talked about things that are under the earth in a conceptual idea in terms of how we understand the conception of the things that are under the earth. And we also can think about Christ's humiliation and his exaltation. So let's chart the gospel as Jesus came and lived among us and rose again. So we talk about the incarnation when he came from heaven to earth. That is called the incarnation. That is also part of his humiliation. It's not just the cross, but it's the fact that he took on human flesh that we count as being part of his humiliation. Then he went even further to the cross, the humility and the shame of a cross, being naked on that cross and dying for us and in our place. His humiliation continues. Then he descends even further under the earth to the place of the dead. And he is then resurrected. He rises up. He is the one whom death cannot hold. And he is finally ascending into heaven. The question I have for you guys is, when did his humiliation end and when did his exaltation begin? Not with the descent. When he went to the grave, when he went to the place of the dead, he went as a victorious king, as a conqueror. He was exalted even then. And so that means that that exaltation is good news for us. For those of us who believe in Jesus, the grave is no longer the same thing. It's even been transformed as we compare to Old Testament saints, I would say. That the grave is something completely different because now we are with Christ forevermore. We're with him. You see, Christ's incarnation and Christ's resurrection, there is no gap there. There's no gap in terms of the incarnation. Jesus Christ did not cease to be incarnate even on Holy Saturday. You think about that. The incarnation is a permanent reality. And because of that, he is incarnate with us. He's incarnate with us. And he's our Lord. So I wanted to wrap up here with a passage from, Romans 6. This is a great word for us. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, that happened in the past, in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all, he died to sin once for all, but the life he now lives, he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. In a sense, we could substitute ourselves with Christ here and say, the death we died when we believed in Jesus, we died to sin. Once for all, and the life we live to God through Jesus our Lord. Amen. And so because of that, you know, Solomon talks about the power of death, but he compares it to the power of love. God's love, when we speak about God's love, is stronger than death. And so Solomon says, set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is strong as death. Jealousy is fierce as the grave. Its flashes are flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. The love of Christ is stronger than death and has overcome death and has overcome the grave for us as believers. And so death no longer holds anything frightening for us. So when Paul goes into Romans 8, he talks about nothing being able to separate us from the love of Christ. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of the Father of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything that is else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. There's nothing from this point on, if you've trusted in Jesus, that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And I think that's important. It's important to me to know that I'm going to be with my Lord even in death. I'm not going to wait for something to come. I'm not waiting for eternal life to start at some particular moment. I'm not waiting to be resuscitated or revived or reanimated. I'm enjoying eternal life with my Lord now, and I will be enjoying it even in death, and I will be resurrected one day in newness of life. Amen. I'm going to close with an illustration, a story from Blaise Pascal. He was a famous polymath who, you know, he was studying all kinds of topics, and he was a theologian, he was a mathematician, he was a scientist. But when he died, this was found in a note was found in his coat pocket, sewn into his coat pocket. Now it's going back. Okay. And I just want to read it to you. It's really, really very moving to me what he said. He said the following. Year of Grace, 1654, Monday, 23 November, Feast of St. Clement. From about half past 10 at night to about half an hour after midnight, fire, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, not of philosophers and scholars, certitude, heartfelt joy, peace, God of Jesus Christ, God of Jesus Christ, my God and your God, joy, 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 tears of joy, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, may I never be separated from him. May I never be separated from him. Now let's pray. Lord, we're awed by your love, that you would send your Son, give him to us. He'd be united to us, even us who are so sinful, and yet he came. He died for us. He went to the grave. He conquered death. He's transformed everything associated with death so that it no longer holds anything fearful for us. It's simply a portal to paradise, to the bosom of Christ. Lord, we thank you for your Son. We thank you for your love, for the great depths of love that you've shown to us in your Son. Help us to love him more, to grow in the knowledge of Jesus day by day. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you.